as an EPE visiting fellow here with us at Santa Fe, and I'm really excited for his lunchtime lecture. Just to give you a little bit of background, Jean-Paul is a professor at the London School of Economics and Political Science in the Department of International Development. I think I got that right. He's also a former project officer for the World Bank on a mission in La Paz, Bolivia, which I think was a pretty interesting story. So he might have some interesting stories about that. He's also visiting, he's had visiting appointments at Columbia University and Berkeley. Some of his research interests, I think, are pretty broad, and I think reflect a really interesting EPE adjacent kind of what we're trying to do under the EPE project. I should say that he is, as part of his visit, he's doing a working group with Jenna Bednar from May 30th to May 31st on instrumental incoherence and institutional reform. So I'm sure he'd love to talk about that as well. He's also doing a book and lecture series on decentralized governance. And today he's will be talking to us about the Encomienda process in Colombia. So thank you very much.
Great. Thank you, Travis. Thank you for a very kind introduction. Thank you to Travis and Will and Mirta for hosting me here, and to all of the colleagues at SFI for the really very warm welcome that I've received since arriving here a few weeks ago, and also for the fascinating and in terms of my own experience, bizarre conversations that I've sort of stumbled into. Like if Sean were to create a Turing machine to mimic himself trying to solve a really difficult physics problem, would it cause the universe to expand or not? And what was expanding was my head, which was exploding as I was trying to listen to this. This is really quite, I'm on sabbatical, and sabbatical is a state of grace, but being here is quite unlike other sabbaticals I've had. So thank you very much. I feel it's a privilege to be here. And this is joint work with Camilo Matajira and Fabio Sanchez. Fabio, in particular, is my longtime co-author and good friend. Who's currently at Columbia University in New York, but he teaches at Los Andes in Bogota, Colombia. And he's online, happily. So I'll try to get through the presentation quickly, and then we can let Fabio introduce himself and participate in the discussion. So I'm going to try to give this a little bit differently from how I would normally do it to a bunch of economists, because I think I don't want to get too pulled into methodology and identification, because the math for you guys is probably trivial, but you probably don't care that much about identification. You want to know kind of what the bigger messages are. So let me try to focus on that. This is a piece that sits squarely in the field of the political economy of long-run development. And there's a consensus, the current dominant consensus in this field, has been taking shape over the last 25 years, and it goes back. Where should I? I can't really point, it's too big. Okay. It goes back to foundational works by people like Engerman and Sokolov and Engerman in the late 1990s, and then a paper on colonial mortality by Acemoglu, Johnson, Robinson that really sort of blasted off the field in terms of going beyond the academy and more into popular culture on colonial mortality. And then also an important contribution by North, Wallace, and Weingast. Douglas North was, of course, the sort of the godfather of the whole field of institutions and development, and that goes back much beyond the 90s. And so the current consensus is that institutions that are inclusive, using different languages of different authors, or that are more equal, or that feature open access organizations and norms of open access to founding corporations, to participation in politics, tend to promote long-run economic, human, and social development. And by contrast, institutions that are extractive or unequal or feature closed access norms and organizations are associated with worse economic and human development. But there's some problems. Now, I love this literature. I was an early adopter in terms of teaching to my students. I've been the head of a master's program at the LSE for some time now. And I love teaching it because I think it's interesting and it's thought-provoking. But over the years, I feel more and more like maybe the emperor has no clothes. Like it's a huge towering edifice, it's very powerful, but maybe it's a bit hollow. So what exactly are these inclusive institutions? For that matter, what are institutions? It was fine to wave your hands in 2001 and say, well, some, you know, Massachusetts and Virginia got better institutions and Haiti got worse institutions, but we would expect more progress in defining exactly what they are. And I don't want to say there's no progress, but it's still a term that is remarkably malleable and whose meaning can change in the construction of an argument. At what level do they occur? Most of this literature proceeds as if these were naturally national-level complexes, and I just don't think that's true. But it doesn't, and without explicitly saying that. And so we get into a situation where it's a bit like the Supreme Court and pornography, you know, like Justice Potter Stewart. I know a good institution when I see it, right? But I can't actually write down a set of characteristics or a set of equations that define them. And now, if I can, excuse me, if I can indulge in a side comment, I see how this gets absorbed, for example, by my master's students. LSE development master's students are very bright people with their hearts by and large in the right place. They don't want to go off and make a ton of money. They want to make the world better. But the way this sort of story gets absorbed by at least some of them is as self-congratulation. Well, you know, we're Brits, we're Americans, we're French, German, et cetera, Swiss. And we have good institutions that treat each other better. And those nasty Nigerians, stroke Hondurans, stroke Bangladeshis, stroke Myanmarese, the problem is that they treat each other badly. They have bad institutions. So we deserve to be more developed. And that's just sort of, you know, anti-analytical smugness. That's a side comment. That none of this literature says that. I would never ascribe this to any of the people I just cited, but it's kind of the way that it tends to bed down that I don't like. So, because I'm new here, just a quick note, my research agenda with Fabio is unpacking these institutions conceptually. So if we have good versus less good institutions, it has to involve government organizations that mobilize resources, make investments, and spend money in particular ways. It has to involve a constitution that sets out the political rules of the game of how governments get selected or elected or designated. It has to be a system of justice and a system of policing that underpins the legal system and a number of other things. And so we need to unpack this conceptually, and we need to unpack it spatially. Okay, so let me come back to the paper now. And in opposition to this consensus in the field, there's a tiny but very interesting and I think very rigorous group of studies, and the number is growing from a very small base, that find exactly the opposite to the consensus. So they find that extractive, oppressive institutions are actually related to better development outcomes. Dell and Olkin, for example, find that in Java, Dutch sugar factories in the 19th century resulted in places today that are richer, more educated, and have better infrastructure than places that didn't get the sugar factory treatment. Summerhill, in a paper looking at the Portuguese Aldeamento in Brazil, which is a colonial institution not unlike the Encomienda, which I'll tell you a bit more about later, those places, and he looks at hundreds of places within São Paulo, which is São Paulo is the state of São Paulo is bigger than most European countries, and it has lots and lots of different places. Some got this treatment, others didn't. And the places that did get it have higher income per capita in São Paulo today. And these are not cross-country studies. So the literature I was citing before tends to proceed with a combination of heroic econometrics, meaning 150 countries over 100 years, or in some cases, 400 or 500 years, with all of the kind of econometric problems about uncontrolled variation and endogeneity that that implies. These studies that I'm citing now are one country, large N studies that look at subnational comparisons. They're preferable, they're sort of attractive in terms of econometric rigor in my point of view. But there are other similar studies that are one country large N that also look at colonial institutions that are finding the opposite results, like Loz and Montero, rubber concessions in the Congo Free State under Belgian rule, where extreme violence was employed to extract rubber. These feature much worse education, health, and wealth outcomes today. Or Rivadeneira in Ecuador, the Concertaje, which is also similar to the Encomienda that I'm going to study, that we study in this paper. These places feature higher extreme poverty, illiteracy, and worse educational achievement today. And these two studies are in line with Melissa Dell's first very famous paper that sort of brought her to everyone's attention about the Peruvian Mita, which was an institution of indigenous, forcing indigenous males to work in Spanish mines in Peru and Bolivia. Those places are less integrated into the road networks. They have lower household consumption and higher childhood stunting compared to places that didn't get the Mita treatment today. So how do we make sense of this? Why is forcing people to grow sugarcane in Java good for long-run development, but forcing them to mine silver in Potosí bad? So we think the answer comes through digging deeper into this conceptually and also statistically, separating inclusivity or extraction from the institutions that are extractive or inclusive and studying their dynamic links. This will help us understand the institutions better and help understand the links between the institutions and development more clearly. And that's what we try to do in this paper. Okay, so now let me actually get into, having hopefully set out some of the broad debates and the state of knowledge, let me try to get into what we do here. And so a bit of history to contextualize this. I think this is just intrinsically interesting, so I hope you agree. Spanish America in South America was very nearly extinguished again and again and again. The initial Caribbean settlements on the northern coast of Colombia and Venezuela were few, small, and very highly precarious. They were surrounded and under constant attack by fierce indigenous warriors who knew the land, the fauna, the flora, and the lay of the land much better, and they had poison arrows, and they killed the Spanish in droves. In 1535, a decade after its founding, Santa Marta was little more than a trading post with 9 horsemen and 40 foot soldiers. Gold became scarce. There wasn't very much gold in that part of northern Colombia. The Great Death was already reducing the indigenous population dramatically, and so the colony was in danger of collapse. And so in 1538, one of the major conquistadores on Spanish Colombian soil, Gonzalo Jimenez de Quesada, led an expedition of 800 Spaniards. Now, this is against an accumulated migration in Santa Marta of 906 people up to that date. So, a large majority of the people who were there on an arduous 11-month expedition of conquest from Santa Marta south along the Magdalena River and up into the highlands. And so this is what Colombia, colonial Colombia, looked like. And you can see Santa Marta is right up here on the coast. And this is a smooth curve describing the route that it would have been nice if they could have taken that, but they couldn't, because Colombia, for those of you who don't know, Colombian geography is absolutely tortuous. So the great Andean mountain chain rises up out of the ocean in southern Chile and Argentina, thousands of miles to the south, and runs as a backbone up the western side of South America until it gets almost exactly to the Colombian-Ecuadorian border, where it trisects into three distinct mountain chains. And so this gives Colombia an absolutely impossible geography. And so this trip that they did is 1,000 kilometers straightest line distance, but they walked anything but a straight line because, they didn't know where they were going. They didn't know where they were, and they didn't know how to get to this place that they imagined, which they actually never made it to, through dense vegetation and impossible geography. Of the 800 Spaniards, 630 died of hunger, disease, drowning, exposure, and attacks by indigenous warriors with these poison arrows. The 170 that survived founded Bogota in 1538, and then Tunja, another city in 1539, which were the major two Spanish population centers on the Altiplano or on the Colombian highlands. These are the two guys that feature in our story. So this is Gonzalo Jimenez de Quesada, and here's the biggest, most important chief in the Sabana de Bogota, Tisque Susa, whom he defeated and then subsequently killed. So the survivors of this horrible ordeal were granted encomienda, yes.
Could you say a little bit more about why they went on this expedition? What was their motivation? What were they expecting to find?
Yeah. So the colony in Santa Marta was close to collapse. The ship had arrived that doubled the population. So there were about 1,000 people there, and the ship arrived with 800 people. And at that point, they started to go hungry. And also, the pressure on the water supply poisoned the wells. And so people, the Spanish in Santa Marta, which is a little dirty, settlement up here on the coast of Colombia, started dying of transmissible diseases through the water supply. And so they wanted to find gold and treasure. In the meantime, Francisco Pizarro in Peru had conquered the Inca Empire in this unbelievable story, which we can talk about later. 176 Spaniards defeated an army of 10,000. and found ungodly amounts of gold that like stopped the press all over Spain for a generation. So people talked about the immense quantities of gold that were being shipped out of Peru. And so Quesada said, well, we're just in the wrong part of South America. And he wanted to get to Peru, right? Now, it took 11 months and most of his people, 630 out of 800 dying to make it to here. To give you an idea, I can't show you where Lima is because it's through the floor. But they thought that they were going to walk from here to Lima. So, part of the broad context is they didn't know where they were. A lot of these guys died on this trip convinced they were in Asia. Christopher Columbus died thinking he'd discovered the route to Asia. He thought he'd made it to Asia, and China was just a little bit further. No? So, thinking yourself back into the 1500s is kind of hard. So they didn't know where they were. They didn't know where they were going. And once they got somewhere, they didn't know what they'd found. What they did find up here was a much more densely populated region where they could enslave the local population or put them under encomienda. I'm going to use the word enslave very, very generally, very loosely, right? So what they were trying to do was stabilize the colonial project by finding treasure. Oh, sorry. Oops. Okay. The survivors were granted encomiendas by the crown. This was part of the deal. The encomienda was a medieval structure, as it were, a feature of medieval Spanish society that got translated and hugely perverted when it applied to the colonies. The deal with the encomienda is that a Spanish conqueror would arrive, conquer the indigenous people, and then was, as according to his rank and status in the expeditionary party, could demand that the local Indians, via the chief and their structure, give free labor to the Spanish lords. And if you're a very important lord, you might get thousands of natives. If you were less important, you might get, tens or hundreds. And they also had to give tribute in the form of mantas, which were cloths of about 1 meter by 1 meter, game animals for food and wood for fires and for building. And in exchange, the Spanish gave you the one true Catholic and apostolic faith. Yeah. About 400,000 people in what is today Colombia at the time, whoops, over large areas of Colombia were subjected to this at the time. They started quickly dying off because of the Great Death, which was largely because of diseases and because of overwork. This was unarguably an extractive, exploitative, oppressive, nasty regime. I mean, I'm not, we have absolutely no intention of trying to justify it or excuse it at all. It was horrible. It was unarguably an important colonial institution that helped structure the entire colonial project. So when Spanish people, why, so Sean's question, why did they stop where they stopped? Because there were large numbers of Indian people there, of natives there, and they could get them to work for them. And then the Spanish conquistadores could kick back and live the life of the Spanish señor, right, of a landed gentry without having to work. That's why they didn't stop in between there because they weren't population centers, but they made it onto Sabana de Bogota, and it was fertile, and there were lots of indigenous people who could work the land for them. So it really structured the empire in terms of where Spanish went, where they settled, what sort of towns they built, and the relations between the Spanish conquerors and the indigenous people. And so our question is, what are the effects of this on long-run development in Colombia? So let me give you a preview of what the final answer is, and then I'll take you back and try to prove to you that this is true. So this horrible extractive forced labor institution, we have fantastic data which we've gathered and digitized and then mapped onto modern maps of Colombia. We know which places in Colombia had encomienda in 1560 because of imperial census. These places have better development outcomes today compared to similar places without encomienda in terms of higher municipal GDP per capita, higher tax receipts, better educational attainment, lower infant mortality, lower poverty, lower unsatisfied basic needs, larger populations, better fiscal performance today by local governments, higher bureaucratic efficiency, but they also have higher levels of inequality, which is not surprising because the encomienda was about institutionalizing and magnifying inequality between two different racial groups. Laurent.
I'm just curious if I should think of encomienda on a spectrum from like none to a lot, or is it just do you have it not in the region when you did the analysis?
So we have a measure of intensity. which then, so we, we use dummies. Do you have it? Do you not have it? But we also have an intensity measure in terms of how many indigenous people are subject to it. Yes.
When you're saying that the Encomienda municipalities have better development outcomes versus those without, you're saying within the country, places that had Encomienda versus places that didn't.
Within Colombia. Yeah.
Okay,
Yeah.
just
Exactly.
making sure, clarifying.
Yep. Sean, did you have? Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yes.
I'm sure you addressed this, but isn't it likely that the places where they got the Encomienda in the first place were better in some sense than the other places? And are you sure that you are able to measure? I mean, the reason why the Spaniards wanted to be on that hilltop and not that one must have had something to do which you maybe can't measure.
Yes. So most of the rest of the paper econometrically is about exactly that.
Okay.
And this is why. So let me go on, and then we can come back to that. We can come. No, but that was So Sam, as usual, has seen straight through. This is what four reviewers have been torturing us for the last year about. So yeah, let me, and then you can tell me if you're satisfied. Okay. Why? So right now, up to this point, what I've told you is a paper that takes a characteristic. There's this weird thing that happened hundreds of years ago, and you get some effects today, and wow, isn't that crazy? So it's better if you can find some sort of logical path or transmission channel, which we do using other fantastic data from the intermediate late colonial period and then the early Republican period. Colombia gets independence from Spain in 1821. We have data from the 17, 18, and early 1900s, and we show, breaking down this effect that we've told you about, that the encomiendas helped to build the local state. So they were unarguably a horrible institution, but at least some part of the surplus that the conquistadores were extracting gets reinvested into building the local state in places that have encomienda. And in places that don't have encomienda, there's nobody building the colonial state. And remember that the Spanish basically obliterated most of the indigenous population and all of the indigenous population's governance mechanisms. So the indigenous people as DNA were almost obliterated from Colombia. Today there's something like 2% of the population. But in terms of structures and civilization, it's all gone, including almost all of the languages. So any state that survives through to today is a state that was built during the colony or during the Republican period. And places with an encomienda built the state, in places without the encomienda didn't. We break this down into three possible channels that we can measure with data, which are also plausible channels, which are building the local state or population centers, along the lines of what Sam's saying. These places were maybe better suited and so tended to have bigger populations. And also the fact that the Spanish were settling there, they had an incentive to try to gather people around them, if only to force them to work for them. And also then a racial composition effect. I.e., the proportion of whites to non-whites. And what we find is that the state-building effect dominates the other two very clearly. Population matters, the racial composition is mixed. It has positive effects in some things and negative effects in others, which is what you would expect theoretically. And then you see lots and lots of historical evidence where you can see the encomenderos founding town halls, the cabildos. The earliest institution of local government is a cabildo. These are founded by encomenderos almost immediately when they settle down, before they get the indigenous people to work for them. And these cabildos do things that are important for local development. They levy taxes and charges, they invest in basic infrastructure, they provide policing and justice, they provide roads, they actually provide water and sanitation in the 1500s. So as somebody who works on development, I'm used to thinking, well, public services are basically zilch. Are all around the world, including the US and Germany and Switzerland and anywhere else you care about, Sweden, until the 20th century. There are almost no public services anywhere in the world. No? And these places, these local governments, maybe because it's the colonies and it's the wilds, and these people have to provide for themselves, are actually providing sanitation management and potable water in the form of bringing water down from the mountain and setting up a public open access fountain in the middle of the town square in between the cabildo and the church. They regulate property rights, they regulate commerce. So they're literally watching over and regulating people who tan leather or sell food, etc. Other places that don't have encomiendas don't get cabildos, and often the lag goes on for centuries. So, for example, Simiti was The Spanish went through there in the 1500s. It doesn't get formally incorporated as a municipality until 1968. Necoclí, 10 years later in 1978. Same story. So the head start is enormous. And so we think we can show that these encomienda-based cabildos and other similar local institutions of self-government mobilize public investments in ways that without doubt suit the encomenderos, but also provide some public good. So here's the data. The basis of the data is that the crown was worried in Madrid that these colonists weren't paying enough taxes. So they sent imperial agents, you know, a number of times throughout the 15 and early 1600s to take a census of all the Spaniards and their assets, their land, and crucially for us, the number of encomienda indios, encomienda natives that were working for the Spaniards. But also how much land, how many hectares, what crops are they growing, how many animals do they have, how big is their farmhouse, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a fantastic resource and we digitize it. The biggest and most complete record, the sort of the best visit was by this guy, Tomás López. And in 1558 to 1560, so the data comes from 1560, and he registers 1,029 encomiendas, which are these, the green places here. So this is the modern map of Colombia. Part of the answer to Sam's question is the Spanish only make it to a tiny minority of modern day Colombia, right? As I said, they didn't know where they were going, they didn't know where they were, and they kind of stopped because they were exhausted and most of them had died. And they choose to found encomiendas in some of these places. Colombia has like a million valleys and a million areas that are fertile land that are good for crops and also, you know, mineral deposits all over the place. And the Spanish occupy a tiny proportion of this. So it's easy, and this is what we try to do, it's easy to set up matching where you find one place that had encomienda and another similar place equally, in principle, equally suitable for development where they just didn't have encomienda. Because, the Spanish, the Colombian state today has not finished occupying the space that is Colombia. The Spanish in the 1500s didn't come anywhere close to that. And Laurent's question about how we measure it, so the shade of green here, you can't see it so well here, a little bit better on your screen, on your computer screen, shows intensity in the number of encomienda Indians or tributary natives. So any green at all is where encomienda was. Where it's white, there's no encomienda. And then the darker shaded greens is more of them. Tomás López chronicles 230,000 tributary natives. There's been a huge die-off. So there were initially something like 400 to 500,000, but about half of them have died. They're only counting male adults, both when they count Spaniards and when they count natives. And so 230,000 tributary native male adults implies a population affected by encomienda of about 900,000. And there are, of course, other indigenous people elsewhere who are not subject to this. Many of them escape. Many of them go back to nomadism, having practiced settled agriculture for 12,000 years at least. They flee the Spanish and they become nomads again, just trying to get away from this horrible institution. And here you have some other statistics or descriptives about encomienda. In terms of modern day municipalities, there are 335 modern municipalities that have had some level of encomienda in 1560 and the rest did not. And so that's going to be the basis of our comparisons. And just to another descriptive statistic to try to settle the idea, to convince you that there's something to look at here. When we look at state building at the subnational level, you see that, so this takes all the municipalities in the data from 1794, and it splits them up into places that did not have encomienda and places that did. You can see that the majority of municipalities did not have encomienda, and a minority, about 40%, did have at least some encomienda, but the vast majority of public officials are concentrated in the minority of places that had encomienda, and only 23% of all public officials in colonial Colombia are in the places that didn't have it. Yes.
Wondering how I should interpret the intensity since it's geographically pooled. Mm-hmm. Is that there's more encomenderos that have a small number of people, or is it there's one main guy who has a lot?
If you're asking me about this number, you can't tell it from here, but we have it in the data. how many encomenderos and how many native Indians. That's there in the data. It's generally the case that there were a few people who had a lot of encomienda natives and then a larger number of people who had smaller numbers, but that doesn't vary hugely across the places where the Spanish settled. So it's not the case, for example, that in some municipality there's only one encomendero and elsewhere there are lots of encomenderos.
So maybe generally I should assume that the darker colors are where there's also more Spanish.
Yeah, exactly. But we're going to control for the white population as well as we go through. Okay, so how do we do this? And this is the kind of thing that Sam was bringing up. There's a ton of endogeneity. The encomiendas were established where natives were settled, and this implies unobservables, locational fundamentals that are probably more conducive to development then in 1560 and also to long-run development today, and these effects might persist, right? So how do we get around this? There's a separate problem, which is that there is almost certainly, and I'm being very careful, you know, my real opinion is there is absolutely totally without any question an undercount of encomienda natives for two reasons. The technology was really poor, right? So the technology of Tomás López and all of his similars was walking, or if he got lucky, riding on a horse across this horrible terrain that had not yet been mapped in 1560, right? And writing it down, you know, on a ledger. And secondly, the encomenderos, the Spaniards, had a huge incentive to try to get the Spanish agent to undercount, to try to get him to skip your farm completely if you could, or if he came, then to try to bribe him or send the indigenous people off into the hills for the day or whatever to get an undercount, because this formed the basis of taxation. No? We know, for example, that a subsequent, this is just one, you know, colorful example, there are many, a subsequent visitador called Egas de Guzmán in 1580s or 90s, the encomenderos got so pissed off at him because he was, you know, doing the same thing, chronicling their assets to raise their taxes, that they convinced the Colombian Catholic Church to excommunicate his ass. And then he fled the country and he went back to Spain because he was terrified. No, and that aborted the mission, and that was the end of that particular visit. So there is no complete data from that visit. There's the data up until the point where he left. No? So my point is the incentives were strong. So the two different things going on, one is endogeneity and the other is mismeasurement. We have three solutions. On the one hand, neighbor pair fixed effects. Secondly, with OLS, with ordinary least squares estimations. Secondly, a method due to Emily Oster at Brown that allows us to analyze the likely bias in these OLS estimates, which I'm going to show you quickly. And then thirdly, my favorite answer to this is neighbor pair fixed effects again, but with instrumental variables, because I love this instrument. And I think the instrument itself is, I mean, this is geeky, but I think the instrument itself is an interesting sort of contribution of this paper to the broader literature. And I'll explain that in a moment. So how does neighbor pair fixed effects work? This has been used a number of times in the literature that's very well established. So we identify via controlling for time invariant unobservables across neighbor pair municipalities. So the idea is that we find municipalities that had encomienda, and then we compare it to all neighboring municipalities of the first one that did not have encomienda, right? The idea being that the closer they are together, the more likely those unobserved variables are likely to be. The more similar those unobserved variables are likely to be, similar weather, similar terrain, presence or absence of mineral deposits, fertile soil, present or absent, whatever it is more likely to be similar between neighboring places than one place and a distant place, right? And so we estimate, let me just give you the intuition of it. We take all the neighbor pairs, and they're sort of the equivalent of an observation, and then we can compare the differences between the neighbor pairs, and we estimate these two equations where this zeta here is capturing the neighbor pair fixed effect that measures the difference between the two municipalities, and then this nu here is capturing other unobservables in the error term. And then we're going to compare neighbors of neighbors in case to capture for spillovers. But this is the first cut right here. So this is the same map I showed you before of the encomienda places. And here you have, without shading, just if there's any encomienda, it's green. And then the purple ones are all the neighbors that did not have encomienda, right? There are a couple of places that you can maybe just about see that are yellow, which are encomienda places surrounded by other encomienda places, and so we drop them. They're out of the sample. And what we find, oh no, sorry. So even with neighbor pair fixed effects, it can be the case that you still have some locational fundamentals or other unobserved variables that we can't capture, we can't control for, that are generating some bias. This is where Emily Oster comes in, and we use her key insight is that you can analyze this by putting in more and more sensible controls into your equation and seeing how the coefficients change and also how the R-square changes. And so her contribution is to say, you've got to look at both things. A lot of the literature, and I mean papers in the AER and the QJE and other top journals, do this by just looking at the way coefficients change as you add more controls. And so she says, fine, do that, but also look at the way the R-square changes. And so the method, I'm going to summarize it briefly, but we can come back later if you want to dig into it more deeply. Let's say this is the true model that you can't estimate because you don't have all of these variables. You don't have data on these true variables that affect the left-hand side thing that you're trying to estimate. So you run a short equation, and then you run a longer equation with the controls that you have, and you see it's kind of a sensitivity analysis. You look at how the coefficients change, and you look at the way the R-squares change, and then you get down to this equation here, which allows you to estimate the degree of bias by comparing your results across these two equations. And then if you make an assumption about what the true R-square is in this first equation, the true equation that you can't run, then you get a sense, you get an estimate, not a precise estimate, but a kind of a sense of how big the bias is from how much the missing data that you don't have is affecting your estimates. So now the real results focus on this first column here. This is OLS in the way that I described of between neighbor pairs. And you see that places that had encomienda, when measured by intensity, by number of tributary natives, encomienda is associated with lower unsatisfied basic needs, lower infant mortality, lower multidimensional poverty, more years of education, higher GDP per capita, higher population, curiously, a lower share of agriculture in GDP. I can't really explain that intuitively. All the rest of it kind of makes sense to me. That's sort of curious, and so, you know, there it is. It's in the data. Also, higher inequality, regardless of how we can measure it, given the relevant measures we have, which have to do with inequality of land holding, right? That's what you would expect because that's what the encomienda was about. And then when we look at long-run state capacity, you see that places with encomienda today have higher fiscal performance, higher tax collection, and higher local bureaucratic efficiency. Now, the reviewers pointed out, and it's sort of obvious, that there could be spillovers. How would these spillovers work? Well, we're comparing neighbor pairs, so it could be the case that if encomienda is associated, as we claim, with better local government institutions, these institutions are providing some public services that may be benefiting people who live in the neighboring municipality that does not have good institutions and didn't have the encomienda, right? So there could be an education spillover, a waste management, a road, that's a better example, a road spillover, or the encomienda place has bigger, better markets, and people who live next door can come and benefit from that market. You know, markets for vegetables and goods, et cetera. So there's a different kind of spillover, which you would expect. I said to you that there's a lot of historical record of indigenous people fleeing the encomienda, right? So they could leave the municipality that has encomienda and move to the place that doesn't have encomienda. Who would you expect selectively to flee disproportionately? The younger, stronger people who are more ambitious or more risk-seeking, right? In both cases, this would tend to to result in an undercount or an underestimate of the encomienda effect, because the non-encomienda neighbor has better results in terms of development because of these spillovers, right? So if anything, we're finding results that are encouraging in terms of what we're trying to prove, but you know, maybe these are floors, maybe these are underestimates. So then we look at neighbors of neighbors. So the encomienda place, and we look at the nearest neighbor of a neighbor, so one municipality away that did not have encomienda, and you see that the results are very similar, but if anything larger, the magnitudes of the coefficients are bigger. The signs go in the same direction. significance is good, but the magnitude is bigger. We think this is a pure encomienda effect, not affected by spillovers, not contaminated by spillovers. Now, obviously, the matching in terms of controlling for unobservables is less good because it's a neighbor of a neighbor, right? But on the other hand, the spillovers are gone. And so now let me take you back. The way that we do it in the paper is we take you through the historical story, beginning with the earliest outcomes, and you see that encomienda is associated with greater state presence in 1794, measured in two different ways, with larger populations in 1780, and with a larger share of white people in the population in 1780. And again, this works with neighbor pairs and with neighbors of neighbors. And then we go through to a medium-term outcome, so trying to trace the channel through time, through the centuries, and we have data for population now in the early Republican period in 1851, and we see that encomienda is positive and significant for that. Also, in terms of local government capacity, revenues are higher, land values are higher in 1870. Now here, for some reason, the neighbors of neighbors thing only works in the first one and not the other two, and I can't quite explain that. Maybe I should skip past this because I want to get to the instrument. Yeah, I'm going to, so this is the Oster analysis. I'm just going to heroically, foolishly wave my hands and say it works. You would expect to, Oster's criterion is that this ratio here should be greater than one for a delta of one, and it's comfortably above one, it's way above one for most of these. We do this for all 20 of the outcomes that we estimate. I'm just showing you four. Anyway, I'm gonna move on because we can come back to this if there's interest, because I want to get to the instrument. So you may nonetheless think, well, okay, that's fine as far as it goes. The Oster analysis is showing that there is some bias, but the bias seems to be small compared to the magnitude of the coefficients we're estimating. But you know, can't we get at this in some better way? And our answer is instrumental variables, and in particular, this instrument. This instrument, I think, is as you can see, I'm a geek, and so I'm excited by it. So we have the detailed account, not only of the stuff that Tomás López counted, but of the route that he took, because we know each village and town that he stopped in over time, over 2 years. So we take this, and we put this, we digitize it, and we put it onto a modern map of Colombia, which he didn't have, and nobody until the 20th century, until the late 20th century had. So we stick it into ArcGIS software with layers of topographical data from a NASA Shuttle Radar Topography mission from 2011 that has all of Colombia's topography, natural features, barriers, et cetera, that allows us to calculate the least cost path of physically going from one place to another using a method that Fagelbaum and Redding use in 2022, but it's not, I mean, it's sort of, you know, a well-established method. And so we can identify the path that Tomás López took, which we're calling the most likely path of the conquistadores, because what was he trying to do? He was trying to count the conquistadores and their assets. And so what did he do in this country that nobody knew, or none of the Spanish people knew? He tried to walk the same paths that they had walked to get to the places they made it to. Yeah? So now this over here on your left are the best previous maps of the routes that the conquistadores took from another crazy Italian guy called Agostino Codazzi, who pitched up in Venezuela in the 1850s and ended up going to Colombia because it was more beautiful and more interesting, and produced the best maps that we have until now of the routes that the conquistadores likely took. And the green spots are places where Tomás López registered encomienda, right? And so you can see that. So, you know, there are different maps here. This one is Belalcázar coming up from the south, from Lima. Here's the guy that we talked about, Jiménez de Quesada coming down from Santa Marta. But you can see that these routes miss a lot of encomiendas. So, you know, evidently, now, Agustín Codazzi had terrible maps of Colombia in 1889, so it's not to blame him. But we have better technology now. And so this is the route of Tomás López that we map according to his account of where he went using this least cost calculation. And then our instrument is the distance from each municipality in Colombia to the nearest segment on the least cost path, which has the attractive property of often producing very different sizes of the instrument for adjacent municipalities, because adjacent municipalities may be close to a very different part of the segment, right? So sometimes the distance is similar and sometimes the distance is different. And that's an attractive feature for an instrument, and much better than the previous instrument we had, which I'll tell you about over coffee if you're as geeky as I am. And the IV instruments line up really nicely with everything else in the paper. And in fact, they're bigger in size, in magnitude. So everything, I won't take you through it again because just you can look at this. This is now all 20 outcomes, you know, medium term, short run, medium term, and long run development outcomes. And they all line up nicely. Significance is very good, is slightly better than OLS, but mainly the magnitudes are bigger. And we think that makes sense because of the undercount. So the instrument is picking up places it really had encomienda in 1560 that are not picked up by Tomás López, right? Because again, of this, the technology problem and the incentive problem that I mentioned before. Okay. And then we try to take this apart through, yes.
So the instrument shouldn't be, the outcome is how well they're doing now, but if it was hard to get there in the 17th century, isn't it hard to get there now?
No.
It's not, they're not correlated.
Sorry?
If it's difficult to get to a place then, is it difficult to get there now?
It's much, much easier to get there now. No, I mean, Colombia has a huge, so you mean in terms of modern development outcomes? Yeah. No. Colombia now has a rail and road network that it didn't have before.
If you looked at Google Maps and said, how long does it take to get from here to here?
Yeah.
There's no correlation.
Getting around Colombia is much harder today than getting around, you know, the Midwest, let's say, or Denmark, where it's very easy to go from one place to another. But the difficulty of getting around Colombia has not been reduced symmetrically over 500 years. It's much easier to go to a lot of places today. Yes.
Jumping on this question of mobility. So least cost paths only use Koebler's hiking function when you're using ArcGIS, which is based on...
I'm sorry, say that again, least...
Least cost paths in ArcGIS only use Koebler's hiking function, which is the idea of how fast you go. It's your velocity, mm-hmm. rise over run across a landscape. And one of the things that I think is interesting about looking at Kodazi's map versus your map is I wonder, because people had been in Colombia for a long time, and usually when colonial forces would come in, they would partner with natives to learn a little bit. There should be roads. There should be paths that some of these folks had been taking already. And so that should already have reduced the cost. And a lot of the time, least cost paths will show you if it's a mountainous area where the bottom is, but that might not necessarily be where people had chosen to walk. More of a comment than a question.
Yeah. No, so I think you're right. I suspect, you know, if I were a Spanish conquistador, I would try to find the routes that the indigenous people had because, you know, they'd been there for thousands of years and that was a good route. And then Tomás López tries to take the same routes. Yeah. But you're saying that the least cost thing on ArcGIS isn't going to capture that?
Not necessarily. And one of the things that so I'm an archaeologist by training.
Okay.
And I do path modeling, sorry. But one of the things that, jumping on what Scott said, you'll see railroads in places where the indigenous paths were, because people have been walking in these places that are somewhat easier and creating these roads. And we see this in Roman roads, we see this in Australia, we see this in the US where our highways are. And so if there are places where the paths are kind of corresponding to something like Scott was saying, that's actually something that we see worldwide.
Yeah.
Which is interesting.
Yeah.
And so the places where the difference were between your map and Kodazi's map, I think, are potentially showing you, potentially, an artifact of ArcGIS, whereas where they're coming together might be showing you something that may be the geophysical constraints of the landscape on people.
Okay, so you're saying we can get more leverage by comparing the Kodazi maps and ArcGIS to see?
Potentially.
Let me do something really cowardly and in the interest of moving on and kick this to Fabio, who's online, because he's the one who actually calculated this least cost path and he has spent more time thinking about this.
For sure.
But I think that's a great...
It's a tea conversation.
Yeah, okay, or better yet, yeah, okay. Okay, great. Okay, I'm gonna blast through the decomposition because I've already told you the answer. So we try to decompose the total effect, which is what I've been telling you up to now, of encomienda on development outcomes into three different subcomponents, which is what I described at the very beginning: state presence, population, and the racial composition of the population in 1780. All we have data for all three of these things. To an extent, we're just limited by the stuff that there's data available for, but it makes sense in particular for the first two things to impact modern development outcomes. And I'm going to show you just these graphs because they're easier and faster to show you. These are the point estimates with the error bars. And what you see, so compare panels 1, 2, and 3, because panel 4 is just the residual. It's the stuff that we can't really explain. It's the leftover. So the things that we can explain are 1, 2, and 3. And you see that panel 1, which is the share of the total effect being mediated by local state capacity as measured in 1794, has larger magnitudes and is more consistently statistically significant than either of the other two. Population also seems to matter, though it matters less. And then the racial composition doesn't seem to matter very much and is sometimes positive and sometimes negative. So we think that this shows you that the story about the encomienda, this horrible thing being linked in some sense to institution building, makes sense, and there's evidence for it. And so to finish, the Spanish encomienda was horrible, but encomienda in 1560 leads to better economic and human development and higher state capacity outcomes today. These results survive a battery of robustness tests, which I haven't shown you for lack of time. So the paper is like 90 pages long, and there are, I feel like Salai Martin, I just ran a million regressions with Fabio, and you know, we can't break it down. No matter what we do, the effect comes through. We do robustness tests in 11 geographic factors, reducing the sample in various ways in our instrument, estimated probabilities of encomienda, of gold and silver mining. We change the comparators between the neighbor pairs, et cetera. We use spatial correlation. It just survives everything. Why? Well, we think encomenderos use some of the resources that they extracted. Let's say that they use their main use of their resource extraction was their own pleasure and benefit, without any question. But at least some part of the resources extracted were used to invest back in the local state because it suited them. They wanted to protect their property rights, not least their property right over encomienda natives. No, they wanted to be able to pass this on to their children. And these institutions ended up doing things like law enforcement, dispute resolution, justice, record keeping, and providing some basic public goods. Where the encomienda was absent, there weren't the big powerful men with an interest in building the colonial local state. Meanwhile, the Spanish were busy destroying what there was of an indigenous state. And so these places suffer from whatever the opposite of a head start is. These places mobilize fewer resources, invest less in the local economy, and spur less development. The effect goes on at the limit for centuries. And we think this helps us explain that at the very outset, I was laying out the land of the literature. Why Colombia versus Java, Colombia and Java versus Peru and Congo? Why do you have similar studies that are finding positive and negative effects of colonialism? Well, we think institution building and public investment explains our story in Colombia, but also in Java. And this is what Dell and Olkin find, that they put it through public infrastructure more than institutions. That's what their result is. Whereas in the Congo, they extracted rubber, this horrible institution, and it left nothing behind in terms of long-run development capacity or state capacity or infrastructure or anything. It was just sucking resources out. And that's the same for the Mita in Peru. And in fact, that result is in Melissa Dell's paper, if you look very carefully, although it's not how people tend to refer to it. So we hope that this paper is going to start to push in the broad political economy of development literature, the focus away from just rights and in these fuzzy institutions back to something that really, really matters in development, but has been lost over the last 25 years, which is the role of accumulation. So rapid development is a wrenching process. It makes lots of people angry. There are lots of people who will be opposed, and it requires huge amounts of resources that need to be mobilized. So we think this is what happened here, and we hope in future resources could be mobilized in a country like Colombia in a very different way that's more democratic and less horrible, but nonetheless mobilizes resources for pouring into public services, public investment, and things that are good for development. And that's it.
I'm curious about the third bullet point here, comparing Colombia and Java with Peru and Congo. I feel like it's all,
I guess my question is, like, why did they leave less infrastructure and public institutions behind? And I thought the punchline was maybe going to be that in Congo and Peru, these processes were not as long in time, so there was no need to create local government. Or I'm just curious about more differences and why there's little of youth left behind.
Yeah, I saw several hands, so I'll try to go quickly. The Belgians did not settle Congo. The Spanish did settle Colombia, they did settle Peru. To a lesser extent, they settled Java. The Dutch settled Java. But in Congo, Congo wasn't even part of the Belgium. Congo was a royal by right asset of the king, King Leopold. And so they extracted like crazy. Very few Belgians went there. And so there wasn't the interest in settling and hence in building colonial institutions like there was in Colombia. So in Peru, Melissa Dell's comparison is between places that got the mita and places that got the encomienda. So she kind of very vaguely, you know, we do a neighbor pair comparison. She does a different kind of comparison between mita versus encomienda places. The encomienda was where the Spanish settled. So there they had a big interest in doing similar things to what we're talking about in building institutions and public infrastructure, et cetera. The mita places, by definition, by colonial construction, were indigenous populations where there were no Spanish, which is why the mita was limited to there, because the Spanish landowners in Peru did not want the authorities to come and take away their natives. They wanted them to work the land, right? So it's actually a very similar kind of mechanism. So a lot of it has to do with settler and settler colonialism. Libby?
Yeah, could you say more about what you think the mechanism of such persistence is? So you've shown, I think, that this stronger local state with corresponding development incomes in, you know, the 18th century, 19th century, and today. But what is the mechanism of persistence of the local state and those development incomes? So you mentioned just now property rights. Maybe there's a protection of property rights, the production and then preservation of local infrastructure and so on. Okay, but isn't at some point, doesn't the relation ties to the national state come in such that that local state persists? Because there's many places in the world where there was a powerful local state, which within a few decades or maybe a century or two crumbled. So I want to know more about why the local state persists as well as the outcomes.
Yeah, our theory is that where the Spanish settle, you get powerful elites who have an interest in this local state, and then that sort of elite interest persists over time through the end of the colony and into the early Republican phase. But you're right that at some point it starts to get articulated with the national government, and this happens differentially in different places. We also, you know, there's historical evidence that the Spanish went somewhere and settled there for a while, but didn't set up encomiendas, maybe because there were no indigenous populations, and those places never incorporate, and any local state just withers, as you say, in the way that you describe. We haven't looked into that kind of fiscal architecture and articulation of local, meso, and national level states just for lack of time, and the paper's already 100 pages long. But I think, so that kind of, so the one, you know, in this agenda that I described at the very beginning, the next thing we want to do is state presence. And I guess, you know, you're giving us a good idea for one way to do that. But I can't give you an answer beyond that right now. Yes.
So you talked primarily about formal institutions, but you hinted at one point about like risk aversion. And so one thing I'm wondering about is like, are there, you know, if you looked at things like, you know, risk-taking, entrepreneurism, levels of trust, those sorts of things, you'd expect that sort of like, if I did like Ron Engelhardt level surveys of these things and then broke them down by region, this kind of builds up your point. Would I see like differences in respect for rule of law, you know, deference to authority, levels of risk-taking, levels of trust, these sorts of things that have just been maintained in local regions? Mm-hmm. Or culturally, would I see no different? I guess it'd be surprising to me based on your story that if I were to look at, you know, micro level world value survey data and break them down into your regions and see no differences at all?
No, I would expect big differences. So Colombia is a super heterogeneous country. And different regions get settled differently. So, you know, the kind of the popular wisdom to these days, people in Antioquia are very, where Medellin is, are self-starting people, they're risk-taking, they're very entrepreneurial, people in Bogota are more sort of small C conservative and Catholic and careful. And this, so, you know, at the level of popular culture, Colombia is rife with this kind of thing. And I think you would see.
But do you think, to Libby's point, that some of this would have.
Yeah, no, that, so that, I mean, that, this is something, can we talk later on this is, about this as well? This is something that we should look into. Yes.
Mobility between the neighbors, because I think your results are really compelling with the different statistics that you have from the encomienda and then the non-encomienda neighbors. Today, is there much mobility between them or not?
Fabio knows that I don't. And there's not, we don't have high quality data on migration between municipalities. It's not captured, unfortunately. I mean, I can say that today it's easy to move from one municipality to another. There aren't very strong structural barriers, and there's a lot of internal migration in Colombia. A lot of it was driven by the violence, right? Yeah. So lots of people fled the countryside and went to the major cities. At this point, that's all I can say. Yep.
Is there any comparison between Encomienda in Peru and Colombia?
Yeah, so you had Encomienda throughout the Spanish Empire from Mexico. In fact, we found out over the weekend that there may have been something like Encomienda here in New Mexico. Without any doubt, it was very strong in central Mexico where the big indigenous populations were. Hernán Cortés imposed Encomienda, and it goes all the way down to Argentina and Chile. But the encomiendas are different in subtle ways in terms of the specifications of the rules, the kinds of tribute, et cetera, and also just the empirical pattern of the number of indigenous people and the number of Spaniards. A lot of Spaniards went to Mexico. A lot of Spaniards went to Peru. Many fewer went to Colombia. So there are interesting differences in sort of, if, maybe that would be the next step to look regionally. Allison, sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, great talk. And this is just kind of piggybacking on Libby and Scott's point, perhaps from a different angle. I loved it. I was thinking the whole time about what Tocqueville said about institutions versus mores, and what Putnam says about social capital versus the impact of institutions. They reach very different outcomes. And that made me wonder to what extent the methods we're using to study these things are driving results.
How do you mean?
Well, for example, in Colombia, I don't know that much about, you know, the indigenous population of Colombia, but I know there are a diverse number of tribes who probably had all sorts of different practices that influenced the developments, that symbiosis between the encomienda and the local population. And it seems to me that the underlying diversity, which is really kind of your origin point,
yeah,
which you're dealing with on the ground, not just geographically, but in terms of people, could potentially drive some of the results.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because Putnam is very interested. Robert Putnam, do you know?
Yeah, 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 no, sure, sure, yeah. Absolutely, yeah.
So it'd be cool if you, I don't know, that's maybe asking you.
Another paper, yeah, the next or next but one. So there's a famous paper in the Economic Journal by Felipe Valencia and William Maloney, that looks at indigenous population, at pre-existing indigenous populations,
yeah,
but they look at the regional level, so sort of one step up from, yeah, what we look at. In Colombia, there's no even halfway decently reliable data on where there were indigenous people, let alone cultural characteristics. Mm-hmm. I've thought about looking at the Murdoch Atlas and trying to map on these supposed characteristics about hierarchy and sophistication of pre-colonial populations. That would be fantastic if we could do that, because I'm sure you're right. There were there were groups that had been, you know, practicing settled agriculture for thousands of years, and others that were nomadic still in the 1500s, and some of them are still nomadic today in the Amazon. No. So they have very different cultural and organizational characteristics, and no doubt that led them to interact with Spaniards in very different ways.
Yeah.
So, okay, that'll, next paper.
Yeah.
Yes.
You talk about similar reflections. I was wondering about the other side of the coin, if you have an idea whether encomiendas developed, also taking advantage of municipalities where there was no infrastructure, no institutions. So basically like colonizing to some extent the other municipalities, extracting resources and stuff like that. And if that's the case, is it even fair to compare that? Like, it would be like comparing Belgium with Congo in this sense, because they just extracted a lot of resources from a place without allowing the local communities to develop their own infrastructure, their own institutions. I don't know if you quantify that or if you have an idea of that.
You're asking me if there are other places in Colombia where they set up encomienda, but where...
No, but if the encomiendas, the places where they were encomiendas took advantage of the resources in the other municipalities around them.
And oh, yeah.
They basically, you know, the development was also thanks to this kind of resource extraction from other places, which hindered the development of those other municipalities where they were not encomiendas.
Okay, so...
They were gone, basically.
Yeah. So, I mean, going back to the 1500s, it's just, I think it's not credible that they were kind of, that the local economy somehow expanded beyond a modern municipal border. Some of these municipalities are larger than small European countries, right? So, I mean, you know, you have to sort of think about the space and think about the technology of 1560. But it is certainly the case that some of these encomienda municipalities had mining in adjacent municipalities, and that was controlled by the people in the encomienda municipalities because that's where the Spanish were. And we have data on that, and that's one of the robustness checks that we run, where we say, okay, is it mining? Is it gold mining? Is it silver mining? We look at them separately and together, and the answer is no. It's where the encomienda was. So if you had mining next door, that's the fact that you have encomienda in this place is why you have more development here, and that pairwise comparison goes through, you know, just like other results. I think we should probably wrap up. Yeah. Thank you.